All right, everybody, welcome to our Thanksgiving service this morning. Welcome to November 26th and our annual fourth Thursday in November, as legislated by Congress and is deemed a day of Thanksgiving. And good morning, everybody. I'm going to open up everybody's microphones because Pat, it's so, oh, you're going to have to unmute your own and say hi for a second. Pat, how are you doing? Has the turkey in the oven yet?
Has been.
It has been. Uh-oh, sounds great.
Yep.
and I'm particularly touched by Julie because Julie is joining us from Florida. Julie,
yes,
how's the weather out there?
Yes, I am. It's 70 degrees already today.
Oh my gosh. That's phenomenal. So you have a lot to give thanks for today.
Definitely. Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's fantastic. And Mary Lou, you're going up and down and over and out. How are you doing this morning? You're also muted. There you go. These technical things. Marilyn, I see you're there also. How are you this morning, Marilyn? Are you with Chuck?
You know, we're here. We're fine. Thank you. Just four of us today.
Fantastic. Yeah. And Onika, how are you doing this morning? Are you feeling thankful?
Extremely thankful and so happy that we can all be together here. Thank you.
Wonderful, wonderful. As am I. And Kathy Graham, the donator of many a turkey. Happy Thanksgiving to you. How are you doing this morning?
Hey, the turkey's in the oven. The rolls are raising and the pumpkin pie is baked.
Oh my goodness. Well, that's terrific. Well, you and I all are getting together to, of course, celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are commemorating this feast day, which is actually on the Episcopal calendar as a feast day for the church. We'll be participating in prayer together. We will be reading scripture together, and we'll be participating in what we all have come to become fond of, which is spiritual communion. And so that means instead of the elements of bread and wine, God knows you guys are going to eat enough today. We will be praying a prayer asking Jesus to be present in the same way. Theologically, as we know, our prayer book tells us that it is the desire to have communion that imparts the sacramental gift of Jesus's presence. So I'm assuming y'all are familiar enough with Zoom, but I do need some volunteers. We're going to scroll the liturgy as we normally do, so you don't have to open any books. But I wonder if we do have somebody who'd like to read our Deuteronomy reading, our reading from the Hebrew Scriptures. Just go ahead and unmute yourself and volunteer, and I'll put your name down.
I'll do it.
Okay, Julie, I heard you. Who'd like to do our reading from the Psalms?
I can.
Okay, Kathy Graham. And then we've got a New Testament reading. We've got a reading this morning from the Christian Scriptures. Who would like to read that one?
I'll do that.
Okay, no. Marilyn, it's on you. And then we've got a gospel. Who'd like to read our gospel this morning?
This is Sonny.
Mary Lou, you're muted.
She's got her hand going.
Is that you, Mary? You want to do that, Mary Lou, the gospel?
Yes.
Okay, great. I think you'll like that one. That's our beautiful tale about Jesus, about somebody returning to give thanks. And then prayers of the people. Who'd like to lead our prayers?
I'll do it, Father Chris.
Okay, who's that?
Onika, sorry.
Onika, got it. Okay, no problem. Well, wonderful. Well, listen, we're going to take just a brief moment, and I invite you as we continue to welcome folk to our service this morning, I invite you to, hello, Edna, to take a moment of quiet and let's just settle our hearts. I want you to think of, Mr. Rogers used to say this when he talked to crowds frequently. He'd say, take a moment and say thank you for somebody who's responsible for getting you here this morning. So let's take a moment to do that. I'll ring the bell. We'll start our service. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. and blessed be God's kingdom now and forever. Amen. Together, my brothers and sisters, let us say together the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And Kathy, I'm going to ask you to unmute, because when I say the Lord be with you, I like to hear somebody responding. So would you do the responses for me?
Sure.
Okay. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and gracious Father, we give you thanks for the fruits of the earth in their season and for the labors of those who harvest them. Make us, we pray, faithful stewards of your great bounty, for the provision of our necessities and the relief of all who are in need. To the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I would invite you, Julie, to unmute your microphone and lead us in our reading from Deuteronomy.
A reading from Deuteronomy 8:7-18. Moses said to all Israel, "For the Lord is your God, is bringing you into a good land." I have to move. Hold on a second. I have to move things around here. Let's see. Okay, there we go. Moses said to all of Israel, "For the Lord your God is bringing you into a land with flowing streams, with streams and underground waters welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land where you eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones of iron, and from those hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. Take care that you do not forget the Lord is your God by failing to keep his commandments, his ordinances, and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. When you have eaten your fill and have built fine houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks have multiplied and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrible wilderness and a rid and arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow from you from flint rock and fed you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and test you, and in the end, to do you good. Do not say to yourself, my power and the might of my own hand have gotten me this wealth. But remember the Lord your God. It is he who gives you power to get wealth, so that he may confirm your covenant that he swore to his ancestors, as he is doing today." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The psalm is Psalm 65. You are to be praised, O God in Zion. To you shall vows be performed in Jerusalem. To you that hear prayer shall all flesh come because of their transgressions. Our sins are stronger than we are, but you will blot them out. Happy are they who you choose and draw to your courts to dwell there. They will be satisfied by the beauty of your house, by the holiness of your temple. Awesome things will you show us in your righteousness, O God of salvation, O hope of all the ends of the earth and of the seas that are far away. You make fast the mountains by your power. They are guided about with might. You still the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, and the clamor of the peoples. Those who dwell at the ends of the earth will tremble at your mighty sights, and you make the dawn and the dusk to sing for joy. You visit the earth and water it abundantly. You make it very plenteous. The river of God is full of water. You prepare the grain so you provide for the earth. You drench the furrows and smooth out the ridges. With heavy rain, you soften the ground and bless its increase. You crown the year with your goodness, and your paths overflow with plenty. May the fields of the wilderness be rich for grazing, and the hills be clothed with joy. May the meadows cover themselves with flocks, and the valleys cloak themselves with grain. Let them shout for joy and sing. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Marilyn, I would invite you to unmute your microphone and lead us in our reading of 2 Corinthians.
The second lesson, 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 15. The point is this. The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the one who sows bountifully will also reap. Each of you must give as you have, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work, as it is written. He scatters abroad, he gives to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others. Well, they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee.
Did we lose Mary Lou there, friends?
I got it back, Father Chris.
Okay, super. Keep going.
As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him, keeping their distance. They called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My friends, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. You know, days like today, and I'm not going to make a political statement, folks, but I want to get out my MAGA hat. Make America grateful again. Wouldn't it be great for us to really be consumed as a nation? I've even thought as a New Year's the year of 2021 to name it for our parish, the year of gratefulness. And you may ask, well, why would I want to do that? And it's simply because there are some amazing benefits to being grateful. I think you guys have known that I've preached on this enough, but people who practice gratitude consistently report a host of benefits. The physical benefits, people who practice gratitude, and I'm talking about on a regular basis with a gratitude journal, or I have like a gratitude list that I look at almost every day. And the benefits of being involved in a regular gratitude practice is a stronger immune system. People are found to be less bothered by aches and pains. Lower blood pressure, scientifically proven. They've done a lot of research on gratefulness. People who are grateful tend to exercise more and take better care of their health. They tend to sleep longer and feel more refreshed after they've slept. The psychological benefits include higher levels of positive emotions. Not a surprise there. People who are grateful are proven to be more alert, more alive, more awake. People who practice regularly gratitude, who give thanks, experience more joy and more pleasure in life, and tend to be more optimistic and experience greater levels of happiness. The social impacts of a gratitude practice include being more helpful and generous and compassionate. They include being more forgiving, quicker to forgive. They include being more outgoing and feeling less lonely and less isolated. You know, I wonder, I don't know how about you guys, but when you ask somebody their favorite holiday, many people say Thanksgiving. And I think this is a reason, is because Thanksgiving is actually good for us. And so what I'd like to do is share with you a little bit of information from a scientist, a guy named Dr. Emmons out of Berkeley, UC Berkeley. He's written this book. It's called The Little Book of Gratitude. He is probably the foremost researcher in gratitude. And what he does is he outlines, because I want to give you guys something to take to your Thanksgiving dinner today. He outlines something called ARC, A-R-C. That's those are the three letters that we're asked to memorize. And what that stands for are the reasons that gratitude makes us resilient. Why does gratitude make us resilient? Why is it kind of good for us? Well, gratitude first, the A, stands for amplifies. Like a microphone or an amplifier, gratitude tends to pump up the volume of the good in our lives. You know, I've talked about this before. One of the things we can do to experience more joy in our life is to reframe our situations in a more positive light. Okay, it's not to deny that you've got, you know, bad things going on or to deny reality, I should say. What it is to reframe what you're going through in a more positive light. The good that we see in ourselves, the good that we see in others, and the good that we see in the world are multiplied and magnified when we have a grateful outlook. So that's the A, is amplify. The second is R, and that means that gratitude rescues. What do I mean by that? Well, left to our own devices, our minds tend to like hijack like every opportunity that we have for happiness. We'll always find like a way, like, oh, I got my dream car. Yeah, but what's the insurance going to cost? You know, I mean, we find a way to kind of hijack our negativity, our entitlement, our resentfulness, our forgetfulness, our ungratefulness. They all clamor for our attention. Now, whether it stems from our own internal thoughts or from the daily news headlines, we are exposed to a constant dose of negativity. And so we look to gratitude to rescue us from that constant dose. Weighed down by negativity, we tend to be worn down. We tend to be worn out. Many of us have experienced COVID in not an uplifting way. And one reason is because we do get surrounded by negativity in ways that we don't usually get surrounded by those things. To offset then this chronic negativity, we need to continually and perpetually hear the opposite, right? Which is good news. We need to constantly and regularly create and take in positive experiences, things we're grateful for. Gratitude, of course, is our best weapon here. It's an ally to counter these internal and external threats that rob us from sustainable joy. So that's A, R, it rescues us, and then C, gratitude connects. Gratitude connects. What do I mean by that? Well, we cannot and do not live alone, obviously, although sometimes it feels like it with this pandemic. One just needs to imagine human relationships existing without gratitude. What would it be like, right? We wouldn't have them long because we wouldn't forget. We wouldn't. We talk about ourselves the whole time. We wouldn't forgive people. Our relationships would basically unravel without gratitude. Gratitude is like a moral cement. And again, I'm quoting this all from Dr. Emmons from UC Berkeley. And he says gratitude is like this moral cement. It's like this all-purpose glue, this emotional spackling that squeezes into the cracks between people, and it strengthens and solidifies these relationships. Without gratitude, we'd be in relational ruin. Organizations, families, societies, they all would crumble. So the ARC, to take to your Thanksgiving tables, gratitude amplifies, gratitude rescues, and gratitude connects. And then finally, because I know a lot of us, you know, being grateful, you don't always feel like it. And in COVID, let's face it, it's tough to feel it. And so Diana Butler Bass, in her wonderful book, if you don't have it, it's a good one to get. It's called Grateful. But at the very end, she has like this Thanksgiving prayer. And she talks a little bit about the process of writing this book. When she did it, she was in a place where she was just not grateful. And she just try as she could, she couldn't feel grateful about much. And what she did was she came to this this idea that she kind of asks us to contemplate on this day, I think, is not to give thanks, but to choose thanks. Okay? So don't give thanks if it's not in your heart, if you just don't feel like you got a lot to be grateful for. But choose thanks. Choose to be grateful. Choose to see grace. You know, there's that old saying, and it's false on many levels, but it's true on many others, which is fake it till you make it. And the idea is not to be disingenuous about our feelings and try to give thanks when you don't feel like it, but try to choose thanks and make thanks. Amen.
Amen.
Together, let us declare the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Onika, I would invite you to unmute yourself and lead us in our prayers. Okay. And Kathy, I'd invite you to be the people and do the responses for us.
Let us give thanks to God, our Father, for all his gifts so freely bestowed upon us. For the beauty and wonder of your creation in earth and sky and sea.
We thank you, Lord,
for all that is gracious in the lives of men and women, revealing the image of Christ.
We thank you, Lord.
For our daily food and drink, our homes and families and our friends.
We thank you, Lord.
For minds to think and hearts to love and hands to serve.
We thank you, Lord.
For health and strength to work and leisure to rest and play.
We thank you, Lord.
For the brave and courageous who are patient in suffering and faithful in adversity.
We thank you, Lord.
For all valiant seekers after truth, liberty, and justice.
We thank you, Lord.
For communion of saints in all times and places.
We thank you, Lord.
Above all, we give you thanks for the great mercies and promises given to us in Christ Jesus our Lord.
To him be, go ahead.
To him be praise and glory with you, O Father, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And so, my brothers and sisters, let us pray together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, at this time, we are rightly separated one from another and unable to gather around the Eucharistic table to break bread and to drink wine. And because it is the desire of God's people to participate more fully in the life and ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us now invite our Savior more deeply into our hearts by praying a prayer of spiritual communion following our confession. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your way and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Together, let us pray. In union, O Lord, with the faithful at every altar of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, I desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. I present to you my soul and body with the earnest wish that I may always be united to you. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all the love of my soul. Let nothing ever separate you from me. May I live in you, and may you live in me, both in this life and in the life to come. Amen. And our post-communion prayer, here, my friends, together let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for feeding us with your holy presence. May it so draw our hearts to you, so guide our minds, so fill our imaginations, so control our wills, that we may be wholly yours, utterly dedicated unto you. And then use us, we pray, as you will, and always to your glory and the welfare of your people. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, my brothers and sisters, go as thankful people, rejoicing in the freedom and the blessing of gratefulness. And may God hear and respond whenever you call. May Jesus make himself known to you in all things. And may the Holy Spirit open our eyes and set our hearts on fire with love. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and be with you this Thanksgiving morning and always. Amen. Let us go forth into the world to love and serve God and our neighbor.
Through worship, outreach, and love for all.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, listen, I'm going to stop recording.